First, I want to give a huge shout out to Martin, and he is a champion of these seminars. It takes a lot of work to do these, sitting here for 3 days. So give Martin some, and Pinball News, you guys, check out Pinball News. Martin would love to have your attentions. So today what we're going to talk about is content creation for YouTube with pinball and video games. And I have a very distinguished panel here. So over there is Retro Ralph. So we got Retro Ralph.
Hey guys.
We've got Emoto Harney. She works with Stern, with Marco Pinball. She has Emoto Arcade. She is a superstar in the pinball world in the media sense. So Emoto is a rock star. We have Frank Lindenmuth from No Quarters Arcade. You guys always refer him as Mr. Frank. Mr. Frank. And also, he has also been a huge part of TNT all these years. So,
Frank takes all my crap.
He does. Yeah, and then we have, I call him Sir Todd. It's Sir Todd Tucky from TNT Amusements. And then myself, Jeffrey Oler at Arcade Hollywood, and it's some fashion during the last 5 years we've all collaborated together in this crazy and fun pinball and video game universe. So right now I kind of want to share a couple clips. So without further delay, I'm going to share Retro Ralph's little teaser here.
Hey, what's up? I'm Retro Ralph. As the name suggests, I focus on things that are old. So you could say my name should be Old Ralph. But anyway, this is your ultimate destination for a nostalgic trip down memory lane. Step into a world where pixels and joysticks reign supreme, and classic gaming is celebrated like never before. Look, arcade gaming in the 80s and 90s was a truly magical time, and the sights and the sounds are etched into our minds forever. It was a simpler time, though, where we didn't have a care in the world other than finding our next quarter so we could play a little longer. Tune in each week to see my latest arcade pickup, learn about arcade history, fix and preserve games, and dive into all things arcade gaming. And sometimes pinball, too. But everybody wants more, so for more arcade content, you can catch me on Chasing Nostalgia, where we travel the country in search of gaming's hidden gems and forgotten treasures.
We're literally on the roof. This is nuts. There's arcade stuff in there.
There's arcade stuff in there, I promise.
It's creepy in here.
And we attempt to answer the question, why do people do it? But you'll have to tune in to find that out. Don't worry though, you can watch it from the comfort of your own home. Hours and hours of retro goodness delivered all the time, pixel by pixel. So, in a world swept up in a digital revolution, we stand as pinball and arcade gaming's last hope. The future of retro gaming relies on our passion, and we're here to keep it alive, defying the march of time with each game that we play.
So Retro Ralph. So I would like Retro Ralph to take a couple minutes here and introduce himself to you guys and explain where he came from and how he got here.
Where I came from? Yeah. All right. I came from Lincoln, Rhode Island. So it's interesting. I actually wasn't that, I know you guys are all pinball people. I wasn't that into pinball, really. I was kind of this, I always felt this deep connection to arcade gaming, and it was because I don't want to get choked up out here, but my grandfather used to take me to the arcade. He's no longer with us, but that's kind of what sparked like the passion to start the channel. It's just like, I kind of felt like, wow, there's probably a lot of people, and there were people already doing it, but there's a lot of people that probably have deep nostalgic connections to things that came from when they were in the arcade with a parent, with their friends, whatever. And so it just seemed like a good time to do it. And it kind of took off from there. And then the pinball stuff didn't come till actually 1 year when Jeff and I started, we met. He goes, you should come to Pinball Expo. I think you'll really like it. And honestly, this is my reaction. I'm like, pinball, do they even make those still? Like, I seriously didn't even think like pinball was a thing. So he reintroduced me into this universe. And everyone at that show, that first Pinball Expo, was like, I guarantee you in 5 years, you're going to have way less arcade games and you're going to have a ton of pinball machines. And then some guy's like, don't do it, guy. They're going to multiply. And sure enough, I had about 35 arcade games. I'm down to about 17, and now I have two pinball machines, and there's a window where the last couple spots are, but there's going to be, my wife's just going to have to be cool with putting pinball machines in front of the window because I'm hooked. I love it. And it's an honor to be here. And I love this show because everyone that comes here, I feel like you guys are like the uber super pinball people. And I love that. Like everyone here is super passionate about it. And I really did mean what I said in the video. I really think that, and we might get into this in the panel, like we're kind of the last hope because you don't see a lot of 20-year-olds in this room. So we got to get and recruit some newer people and get them into the hobby as well. So that's my little spiel for you guys.
I'm proud of ruining Ralph. Once you come into this world, you get ruined. You're like, oh, I'm going to get pinballs forever now. Next up, I want to talk about Emoto. I don't have a clip to share with Emoto, but she has Emoto Arcade on YouTube. She does Marco Specialties out there. They do live repair videos. Emoto's always online. Emoto, please tell me about your little journey in this crazy world.
Hello, everybody. So I started making arcade walkthrough content in around 2011. I grew up hanging out at arcades. That's where I got all of my social skills as a teenager. It was a very important part of my life. And when the last death of arcades kind of happened and more ticket redemption started coming up in 2004 or whatever, it was like very heartbreaking. There was no third space for us to kind of hang out at. So just by happenstance, by trade, I'm a cinematographer and I have a production company, Captain Crazy Productions, and that took us up here to do a horror movie in 2011, and I randomly found Galloping Ghost Arcade. And I tell you, when I walked in there, I cried. And I just immediately pulled my phone out and shot a video and was like, everyone, arcades are coming back. This is amazing. And from that moment, just all across the country, like arcades started popping up here and there. And it was kind of my life journey to find that place, do a walkthrough video for them, and convince everyone to go and support it just so we can help see this thrive. And now, 2023, we have almost every major city has several pinball and arcade spots, which is amazing. And that journey led me to meet Marco Specialties at shows and meet Stern Pinball at shows. And we just started collaborating in around 2019, and you know, the rest is history. We have Marco TV, we've done like the Stern Heads Up Pinball Invitational, which got on CNN, the Ocho.
ESPN? Thank you.
ESPN. You guys, I was like, that does not sound right in my head. ESPN. the Ocho. And yeah, just the whole thing is to just keep promoting arcade culture. For the socialization and the community of it, and of course the games, and just keep keeping pinball out of the landfill. So I will be working with Marco Specialties for the rest of my life. I promise y'all, they are my family, and their whole goal of that is my goal and passion. So happy to be here with all of y'all.
So next we have a clip. Like I said, we have a clip from our good friends at TNT Amusements.
Well, I started my YouTube channel in 2010, Frank. You know how many years ago? 13 years ago.
No, I didn't know.
Yeah, 13? Well, you didn't know.
13?
13 years ago. And I find the channels informative. We show people how games work. We do tech tips.
Open a box of coffee.
And we open up coffee. We also do green screens. I wonder whose idea that was.
That was my idea.
It was.
The problem with that was you had to green screen everything. I was like, no.
No, I stopped. But, Frank, do you remember you appeared in one of my green screens?
I
happen to have a clip here. Look. And full of curious creatures, huh?
Man, we have to race.
I want to race too.
Me too.
Me too.
You think that's going to happen?
Me too. Where's my rage?
I want to raise two.
So do I.
I can't smile any louder. I hate smiling.
Hi, folks. Okay, Todd, this is the game done yet.
You see, I told you. You made a great appearance there. This is
so weird.
Now, the really neat thing is Frank has his own channel now, both on YouTube and Facebook, and now he just started with the TikTok.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, I got some footage from that.
We got the rotisseries all painted and assembled. As you can see, now we're starting to use it. This thing is definitely a thing of beauty. With just the sliders, you said, and then the sidekick adapters. But the problem he was having is his special solenoids weren't working right. We replaced this chip, puts a board back in the game. Special solenoids work, but the displays aren't working. And like I'd said, I thought about it for a few minutes and I knew exactly what the problem was. And then I asked you to post below, what did you think the problem was? And most of you, a couple of you had a couple of good answers.
You see, Frank, I got you covered there. So Frank's takes a different approach. He doesn't have any humor in it either. You gotta have funny stuff.
There's no much fun to have after you've had all the fun.
No.
You don't save any for the rest of us.
And you have to have comedy in the show, because comedy is an important part. And for comedy, I've chosen somebody very special. It's my identical twin brother, Rob.
Yeah, but in my videos, it's just me. All comedy needs its resident dummy. I don't have a dummy.
You mean like this?
Oh! Yes.
And you gotta have a slap like that. I'll never forget when my brother asked, how am I going to get a hold of you, when I was at this very Pinball Expo show 5 years ago.
Yeah, not 150 years ago.
Yeah, but Frank came up with this.
Smoke signals?
The Rob Tuckey Communications Center.
And it actually works.
And it works. Listen, Rob, I need you to send money to the shop.
I'm hearing ringing in my ears.
That's pretty good, huh? Anyway, so, tech, comedy,
stupidity,
fun, and green screen. That's how we do it.
And Christmas vacation.
Oh!
Okay.
We are sorry.
So right now I'd love for Todd and Frank to give you guys a little rundown of how they got started and, you know, where they're headed.
Well, obviously, is it on? Okay. Obviously, I mentioned we started in 2010, and it was actually accidental. One of the videos I sent to a customer who we fixed a game for, the YouTube was very crude back then. You could only upload 15 minutes at a time, and apparently, I missed the private or unlisted and public. And the video was public, even though it was directed at the customer. And all of a sudden, I got all these comments. Oh, wow, this is great and all this. And I said, wow, there's all these people that want to know about these games. So we started making videos that I occasionally would have some humor in it, but not much. But we discovered to get people coming and watching, we would continue with funny stuff, but also learning. I want the videos to be enjoyable. You can watch with your family. Anything said that we could bloop out if necessary,
right,
and keep it a G-rated. And YouTube also is important. The more stuff you put up that's family-oriented, the more they'll circulate your video. If your videos have, you have to swear that your video has no violence. No, you have to check all these checks off before your video goes up. So I always get a green, and they can occasionally watch my videos to make sure they're green. So if you want to get the most people, you have to keep the videos green. You know, you can't talk about terrible topics like, you know, and you wouldn't either. You wouldn't cover that. So the video channel has grown. We have about 43,000 subscribers. But Ralph has more.
I was just about to say that.
Miserable, horrible.
No, I'm kidding.
But I was going to tell you all that our new channel that's growing is on TikTok. And unfortunately, you're filming in the worst possible way, up and down. But I'm getting thousands of views on TikTok. and I'm not getting those views on YouTube anymore. And the kids are watching the TikTok. I can't tell you if you will get new customers, but the TikTok videos could be anywhere from 1 minute to 10 minutes. That's the most you can put up. And you can't edit them. Once they're up, that's it. And but we're getting a lot of hits. I just filmed a 10-minute Elton John. And the nice thing about TikTok, because it's going through China, I don't have to worry about those silly things called copyrights. So I thought, I can't put Elton John up on YouTube, the pinball, but I could make a TikTok, so I have to get that uploaded. You could do everything in your phone. It takes seconds. It's free, doesn't cost you anything, but you don't get paid. So our channel makes about, I'm not sure about Ralph, but I can share, I make like $400 a month on my channel on YouTube. It pays on anything that doesn't have any copyrighted material in it. Anything copyrighted means it's over 9 seconds. So if you can cut your copyright stuff to 8 seconds and then have a pause for 10 seconds and continue it, then you won't get picked up on their radar and you can keep your video making money. They don't seem to be going backward to my older videos. I used to use Living is Good, but now I can't. I can only use about 8 or 9 seconds, and I got to drop the sound way down. I can't use it anymore because it picks up on the copyright. So that's what you got to look at. YouTube allows you to test your video before you make it public, and they'll tell you what you have to change automatically. It's all automated. So I test a lot of the videos. Everything I've filmed at the show so far came up clean. I didn't have to re-edit or cut. But the Tommy would never work. So if you want to put stuff up on Tommy and you're a monetized station, you won't make any money. But, you know, that's why the way it is. And I guess you'll find that out too. I'm sure both of you have been slapped with Mr. Copyright.
Yeah, my last, is this, oh, this is working. My last video from here, I think it was, I even had, sometimes you have to go through and you have to supply the licenses of the songs, and I got it, I don't make a lot of money on it anyway, it's about the same as you said, so I mean, it's kind of one of those things where, of course you'd like to, because you put the work in, but you have to just be careful. There's sites, though, that I use, I don't know if you use it, like Epidemic Sound or something like that. Yeah, you pay a subscription, then you can use whatever songs you want, well, the songs they have, basically.
What's interesting, my daughter, Tammy, you a lot of you know, she's on her second album. And one song I'm using a lot now doesn't hit the copyright. But another one that's from the movie Avatar, and it's her music and her voice. There's nothing from the original score, but I get a copyright. It's not a strike, but I just can't earn any money from it. So it's rather interesting what they find. It's the melody that could be copyrighted. Sometimes even the lyrics, I suppose. But out of my 2,500 videos I have up now, 70 of them I can't earn money from. That's not too bad. But once again, I do re-edit. Frank doesn't have that problem. Oh, Facebook will silence your video. The hell with they don't give a crap. They'll just turn all the sound off on your video. The hell with them. They, at least with YouTube, they'll tell you, and you have the option at that point to replace the music with something else. And then your video will be monetized again. But
Todd, how old are you now? You just turned what?
68.
He just had his birthday. 68th birthday. And
so Frank,
the fact that you're 68 and you use TikTok and I'm 44 and I don't is kind of embarrassing, actually. So you need to teach me how to use TikTok while we're here.
But you notice that Ralph has a very sophisticated editing software. And I'm using 2002 speed editing software.
My sophisticated editing software is right there in the front row.
That's our Mason right there. Yeah, it's really neat. But we've had a lot of fun. Frank, why don't you talk about what you're doing now with your videos?
So I'm more into the technical end of it, even though I've been playing the games since they were first going to an Acme supermarket in Philadelphia in 1980 and. There just happens to be a Pac-Man machine in there, and I'm playing. I was never any good at them. I was always good at fixing them. I like to play a little bit, but sometimes I'm just more interested in what's under the hood, because eventually at some point in time, you're going to need to fix it. And I don't ever want to have to depend on anybody, so I learned how to do it myself. It's just something I've always been into, electronics, mechanical stuff, cars, whatever. So I try to put a lot of information out there so people who want to do it can do it themselves. But I don't just put it out there as, well, this is what the problem was, this was the fix. And if you saw that little clip I posted, I knew what was wrong because I understand what it is I'm messing with. And you have to, and a lot of in my videos, I'll put at the end, experience knows no substitute. And that's the truth. You can sit there and watch videos until you puke coat hangers. Just get out there and mess with it. Don't blow yourself up. Don't get hurt. I always say that. But once you mess with it and you start figuring out how it works, what it does, what it's supposed to do, you got to look at all the pieces. And I try to present it that way. And I'll say, hey, this is what it was. And I'll have tinkered with it. And I stumbled on it, or I knew, or I got pissed off and threw it on the shelf and came back to it 2 weeks later. And I have one guy, he was commenting, oh, well, we all knew what that problem was. And he'd take little screenshots of PinWiki. And I said, yeah, I said, this isn't for you. This is for the guy that doesn't know, who doesn't know about PinWiki, who doesn't know about the Facebook groups or wherever you want to go to look information up. It's how to think. What is going on? What's not working? How I got to it? And hopefully that'll stimulate your intellect to say, okay, I got this. So that's really where I'm coming from. Because how many videos do you need about Pac-Man and pinball machines? And so I just take a different approach.
Well, that's cool. So we have one last clip, and then we will go to questions. This actually, the time goes by fast with these seminars. So
this is my clip.
Oh, yours. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So
the best for last.
This is Jeff's clip.
G. Todd.
By the way, he has his own.
Yeah.
Channel.
I am moderating, but I'm going to share a little love, too.
Jeff has his
own
channel. Yep.
Okay. So here I am, everybody. Doc, what's the official name of this game?
This is Sega's R360 with G-Lock. There's an emergency stop button there. There is a missile button on top.
For you to get in this thing.
How much?
$10.
$10? $10?
You've done less for more.
You made some stuff in there.
We did it. We got the multi-ball. Here we go.
Bogey? Bogey? Wake up, Bogey. Don't dream about biting one-ups. He goes, I just bit a one-up and just...
Build an atomic blaster!
It will never work!
Get every available man!
Your cities will be destroyed!
Destroy the saucer!
Was my little victory. I got my start in 1989. I found an Asteroids Deluxe on a newspaper ad in the Dayton Daily News back in Ohio, and I was addicted ever since. And I started YouTube in 2014. Rob Burke got me into this pinball world. I want to say it was 2016, and I've been my passion here is to collaborate with everybody because I love the video aspect of it, but I also have passions for the game. So that's pretty much me in a nutshell. But we have questions that we're going to ask each other. We're kind of running out of time. Did you guys want to do a Q&A now, or did you want to throw some questions up for us?
Let them ask.
Yeah, did you guys, you know what, like, I thought we just, let's go ahead and open it up to questions out there. Does anybody have questions for these guys out there? Yes. Oh.
A slider from White Castle?
Slider? Well, I do have some prepared questions. Oh, geez. Anyway, so I'll...
Right to ground, it's going to be 330 ohm, half watt. You put a quarter watt in, it's going to fry. And I don't want you complaining you burned your house down.
I'll kick this off a little, Todd. I'm going to pose a question to the four panelists here. What is the... my thing is, what do you love about Expo? So we can start. Todd, you want to start?
Well, first of all, this is the best expo ever. So if this is your first time here, baby, it doesn't get any better than this, except maybe next year. And remember, all of you can join us after closing at the fireplace. I understand people didn't leave until 5 a.m. last
night. Yeah, the fireplace is a whole nother story,
right? So we crashed out at 2 a.m. But we share laughs and stories and fun. Expo is about the games. We had all these wonderful releases. Expo is also mostly about the people. The people are the most important part of any expo or any arcade show or pinball show. And all of you know that. Yeah, you want to play the games and see all the new stuff, but then you want to talk to your friends about what you just bought and what you just got. It's fun. It's fun to compare notes. I wanted to point one last thing out.
Yes.
Every single person in this room could be taught in about 2 hours how to fix most things. If you have a pair of hands, and you got eyes and ears, you could be taught so many repair techniques in just 2 hours, how to trace things. The only real tool you'll need is a meter. It's very simple. Now we're talking about old electronics. New electronics can be fixed if by reseating connectors. That's about it. But the old stuff is simple. Even though it looks amazing, when you open up the back of Twilight Zone and you look at all this stuff, it's not that bad if somebody points out what each board does. And if you have a problem, you can trace it from that part all the way back to the game, to the part in the game. So I just thought everybody should know that. We're teaching young kids now. I've actually got 3 young kids that are very interested. Young, we're looking at 16 to 18. They have been the only kids that have shown any interest in learning about the old, as they call it, the old shit. But
Todd, you're not supposed to say
they're interested. We don't have any kids in here, see? So we could say that.
We do. It's Stringer's a kid.
Oh, a kid at heart.
So, Ralph, I'll pose the same question to you. What does this expo mean to you?
Well, like I said, I was a little newer to Expo, but I kind of go with the whole angle of, like, it's really a cool place to come to just meet other people that are into the same things as you. Like, there are conversations that are happening around that fireplace that we know if we went to, like, a family function and we're like, yeah, we, you know, we you know, you said, like, how do you get the skill shot and blah, blah. They'd be like, what? You know, they don't care. So it's cool when you can come to a place like this and talk to these to other people that are into this stuff as much as you are. So it feels like a safe place for us to be, and it's, like, our own place to celebrate the things that we love. So I think that's kind of the biggest thing for me about Expo. But also, I mean, obviously, the manufacturers choose this time to showcase these new games, which is pretty damn awesome. And you've got, you know, so it's like endless new stuff, but then you have all of, like, Rob's collection there, which is really neat. So if you can't go to Pastimes, I'll give you a little plug for that because it's pretty freaking awesome. If you can't go to Pastimes and experience Rob's collection, you can come here to this show and do that. So, I mean, it's really about the people at the end of the day. I think even if one, a lot of times, it's just kind of sad to say, I guess, but a good thing too. I have more fun talking to everybody than I do even playing the games most of the time. So most of the time, it's like the conversations we have in front of the game, you know, even though the games are really fun. So I'd say the people.
Cool. So Emoto, I'm asking you the same question.
You know, it's going to be the answer for everyone because we have the best community
That's
ever.
True.
I travel. Ooh, nice save.
Nice save, Stringer.
Very nice save. Those tripods.
And Moto, he broke his phone this weekend, by the way, so we know
well,
now.
Well, I'm glad it's not his camera. That A7S2 is awesome. I go to pinball shows all across the country, everywhere. They're all very special. It's all gathering of like regional communities coming together. But what really, to me, makes Pinball Expo stand out is that they draw people from all around the world to hear. And this is like the one event from everyone international. We don't get to see each other except at Expo. So it's a huge family reunion, you know? It's not just this part of the country or this part of the country, but it's literally everyone in the world comes here to Expo to celebrate pinball and arcade together. And that's what makes this show in particular very special.
Good answer. Frank, I'm gonna ask you a different question. What keeps you involved in the hobby? I call it the hobby, but it's, you know, it's an easy term.
It's either you get it or you don't. It becomes a part of your soul, these games. When I was very little, I had a neighbor that had a game in his house, and I thought that was the coolest thing in the world. And I made it my life's mission to have a game. And either you get it, like I said, either you get it or you don't. It becomes a part of who you are. And it's the community, what everybody else said about Expo. We all come here, despite all the craziness in the world, none of that matters. From Wednesday when you get here to Sunday when you leave, nothing matters. We play the games, we have fun. Like Emoto said, we have friends from around the country and around the world. I don't know of any other place that happens. So that's what keeps me into it. The connections you make with the people, the friends you make. It's a lifestyle, I guess. I mean, some people are just casual players. They don't have any games. Some people buy one game and I go and fix it for them and I say, watch out, they multiply. They call me up, I'm buying another game. Can
they
you look
do.
At it? That's probably pretty much it.
Then you build a barn to put them in. That's the next step.
Well, yeah, well, that's it. They have support groups for that, Jeff.
Okay, I'm going to ask Todd. Yeah, we have a good support groups. I'm going to ask Todd a different question. We're going to go on the controversial side here, but it's relevant. How do you handle negative criticism? Yes?
Well, I'll tell you how I handle it. I had somebody that was furious of the video I put up, and he said, I'm going to unsubscribe. So I made a video. Now I circulate this one whenever I have a problem. You may run it.
Cool.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. Excellent. Yeah. Oh, no. I don't have it queued up. I'm sorry, Todd.
Well, that was the whole part of it.
I know. I blew that one. I'm sorry.
Oh.
Sorry. That... So I'm handling negative criticism. So,
well, I just send them the video clip. Doesn't that give you enough time to queue it up and hit the
kinda. Well, we're running out of time, so I thought I'd speed it up a little bit. Yeah.
Okay. Well, I send them a video. Well, the video clip I made with my brother was the ending of the song Sound of Music, where they go up the steps. And they go, goodbye. Okay, and then my brother and I appear in that at the bottom of the steps, wow. Waving at them. Oh, here it is.
Here we go.
We are sorry to see you go.
Actually, not really.
Wait a minute.
That's what viewers would
like. I thought of a great way to say goodbye. Do you see us at the bottom?
Yeah, look at the bottom corner, everybody.
And that's how I say goodbye.
Wait.
Now get out!
Okay. Okay. So I think we have a couple more minutes, Martin, right? Does anyone have any questions for everybody up here? We got, I saw Steven go first.
Thoughts on the alternative video platforms, the trend is people are kind of migrating to the other alternative video platforms because of all the issues they have with YouTube and controversy and stuff. Worth it or not worth it?
Well, any way we can get the word out, the better. As I said, I'm having great success with TikTok. It costs nothing, and you film in rotten vision, and they're still watching it, and you can put a video up in seconds. So the 10-minute Elton John video I'm going to put up on TikTok will be seen by hundreds and hundreds of people, and hopefully they'll go to my website. I show them everything on a QR code, even though some people think QR codes are a thing of the past.
The past.
But they're back. Nobody uses QR codes, no one.
I think
that's an inside joke.
I think that's a good question, but the problem, like, I've looked at some of them, and the problem is what's really hard, and I know, Todd, you have a similar size audience, is it's hard to build it, and then they don't just go over to the next platform, unfortunately. Like, you'd think, oh, all these people subscribe, they're just going to jump over and watch me here, and they really don't, and it's just more because people subscribe to so many channels, and you can send a notification, but think about all the notifications people get. So it's usually good once you build the audience to stay on that platform, unless something changes and there's like some amazing platform that pops up, but it's a good question. Yeah. My boring day job is I sell people basically SSD drives in a big array. I do data storage, so I back everything up multiple times. I might be the freak that does that, but yeah, I work for a data storage company. So it is a good idea though for someone that doesn't do that to back that stuff up for sure.
Okay, we have time for another question, I think. The gentleman right there, Tony.
I got it. Perfection is the enemy of done.
Oh gosh, you're right.
Just put the content out. A lot of times, I think we can all agree, is you get hyper-focused in editing and, you know, you're putting yourself out there, so you want everything to be perfect. And then the time span of when you should have gotten the video out is gone. You know, you kind of lost that momentum. So don't let that happen. Just push the content out. People are very forgiving online. They just want to see what you're seeing and experience what you're experiencing. So just
I'm the worst.
Get it out
I'm
there.
The worst
publish
at
it.
I'm the worst at that.
Me too.
Yeah.
One more thing to add to that. So, like, consistency is so important. So, like, if you really want to get it started, you can't just throw up a video one week and go, all right, I'll get to another one in a couple weeks. So you have to almost, like, set goals and go, okay, I'm going to do 2 videos a week for the next 3 months. And you'll see it'll make such a difference because there's all these, you know, not that we're going to get into it, there's all these algorithm type things where it's trying to say, well, it's trying to find your audience. But if you only put a couple videos up, they're going to gravitate away from you and go, well, this isn't a serious creator. So because they're trying to make ad revenue, right? So they want to find someone that's consistent. So being consistent is like the number one thing. And I totally agree with what you said. You can kill yourself and go want it to be perfect. And that will usually prevent you from uploading a lot. And then, you know, you just won't get the subscriber base.
I think we got time for one last question. The guy in the back.
I can tell you my live videos get more views than my edited ones consistently. So I put 3 videos up at the expo already, and the live one has several hundred more views than the 2 edited ones. Now, they were edited in this. They were pretty crude, but the live videos are what people want.
And my channel's the opposite. So I actually, yeah, my channel, now he's gonna switch to all uploaded videos now.
That's for another seminar.
Yeah, no, the live stuff for me doesn't do as well as the produced content. But it's easier to get started if you can't live at first anyway. You have to like build a subscriber base before you can go live. But uploaded content for me works better. But
you guys, I want to thank everyone for coming to this seminar. I want to thank, do you got something? I want to thank all my very good co-creators and friends for being a part of this. And this is just wonderful here. You know, Expo's, like everybody said, it's a family here. So thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, wait.
Thank you.